Mary Catherine Hamm, Brian Wilson, Brian Neiman, today's newsmakers, and you, the Morning Majority. 105.9 FM. AM 630.
WMAL. 8:37 on the Morning Majority. David Perdoso is with us. He's an online opinion editor with the Washington Examiner. A man who's written several books, and I swear I didn't know that you had written this column when we asked you to be on, but your latest column is very much in sync with the view that I expressed yesterday and caught a heck of a lot of grief for. Let me just sort of read the first few paragraphs, if you don't mind. You are a disgrace to conservatism. For some demented reason, you're trying to destroy a conservative candidate, be it Kane, Gingrich, or whomever. This sort of email you wrote comes in frequently nowadays. So do the angry tweets. That's because it's primary season. Your job, one writer asserts, referring to the job of reporters, is to defend people regardless of their flaws. Our commentary section's conservative lean apparently gives some conservative readers the impression that we are here primarily to help someone get elected, that we should be overlooking the problems in the GOP for the greater good. Continue the thought for me, would you, David?
Well, the argument I make in the piece is that if you want a candidate who is not vetted and you want Republicans to nominate their own Barack Obama, then, you know, by all means, go ahead. But I've been hearing for 2 years, and I firmly believe, really, for 3 years now, that Obama was not properly vetted by the media. That's true. So is the answer to nominate a Republican candidate without vetting him, without looking at what his flaws are, without perhaps noticing that some of them might be disqualifying flaws? And the greatest danger isn't that Republicans are going to nominate someone who loses. The greatest danger is they're going to nominate someone who's unqualified and wins, and then, it's bad enough politically to defend a bad president for 4 or 8 years, but we have a bad president, even more importantly, that would be a bad thing.
I think that's where the frustration comes from. I mean, we see it all the time. We hear it all the time as well. The frustration comes from the fact that, well, the same criteria isn't applied to Obama or Democrats as it is to Republicans. And if you're going to beat them Republicans, how come the mainstream media didn't do it to Barack Obama? I think that's where the frustration comes from.
I think that is exactly right. I wrote a book called The Case Against Barack Obama, basically making the argument that no one was looking at this guy's record and trying to give an account of, you know, the kind of seedy political underpinnings of his Chicago career and all that stuff. I completely agree that the media did not do its job on Obama, but the answer is not to drop the ball on Herman Cain or Newt Gingrich or Rick Perry or Mitt Romney or any of these other guys. If you know, again, it's a recipe to overlook the flaws of a candidate and let him get elected that way is a recipe for a disaster for the country, not to mention a political disaster.
Now, the one thing I don't understand is that people don't have any problem attacking Republicans when they're in office and they're doing things that they don't like. I mean, John Boehner took a whole bunch of heat during the debt ceiling debate and took all kinds of heat during other parts of his tenure. But for some reason, it's with the candidates where it's like you're just not allowed to say anything bad about them.
Right. Yeah. So the person who wrote the email that I quoted there even quoted Stephen Decatur's My Country, Right or Wrong, as the way we should be approaching these guys. That's not even right with our country, but I mean, with your candidate, are you really going to be that serious about a candidate that, you know, people can't even criticize him? Do we live in the Soviet Union here? I mean, come on, people.
Yeah, well, again, thank you for writing that column. It absolutely is in sync with what I was trying to argue yesterday, that in some cases successfully, in some cases apparently with members of our audience unsuccessfully, but I salute you for taking on that topic.
And you've made Brian Wilson feel so much better this morning, so thank you.
I feel good about
the anxiety
that.
Level has come way down in here. Hey, David, can we switch to Solyndra for a minute? Because you were writing about this probably before a lot of people. And what I can't figure out is, first of all, there are lots of companies that try to get federal funding or federal contracts, whatever, and sometimes they have political backers or not. But what makes Solyndra so special? Is it the amount of money? Is it the $500 million? Is it the number of people at the White House who seem to have been engaged and involved in trying to promote its success? What is so special and unique about Solyndra?
Well, I think it's the latter. It's the incredible level of White House involvement, all the way going up to Barack Obama going to their plant in mid-2010 and giving this wonderful speech about how Solyndra is the way of the future, and this is showing how the stimulus works. And Joe Biden said something even more gushing, that this is what the stimulus is all about, when the loan guarantee was first approved. So, clearly, I at the time, back in July of 2010, I wrote a column about Obama's earlier visit there, about how puzzling this was, because the company had already had an audit that showed that it was in huge financial trouble by the time that happened. I believe that was, it was PricewaterhouseCoopers did the audit, and it was released in April of 2010 before they were planning an IPO. And that just showed, wait a minute, how in the world did these guys manage to get the President of the United States out to their plant? And at the time, I have to admit, I didn't quite get it, because I looked at employee donations, that sort of thing. I couldn't find anything special. They had hired some real top-notch lobbyists in Washington, including the wife, former wife of a congressman, to make their case. But what I missed was the fact that their investors, their owners, were included this huge Obama bundler, who now we've discovered, as of yesterday, was urged by the White House to, prevent the management from announcing layoffs
right
until after the November 2010 election.
It's amazing. I mean, it just says that it was politics then. It was probably politics when it originally started. I think we can all agree on that. And politics when they announced it, because Vice President Biden, we have that, back and forth where they said, hey, we want to push this up so the vice president can go there. I mean, it's absolutely amazing. And the taxpayers are holding the bag for $535 million.
No, that's, and the way that they restructured this loan late in the game in a way that apparently violates federal law, so that the private investors got paid before, or get paid in bankruptcy before the government, that makes this even bigger, because that may well be against the particular law that governs that energy program. You can't do that.
All right, David, good to have you on the show. As always, appreciate your time.
Hey, thanks so much for having me.
Hey, thanks for that caller.
Yeah, you're Brian's personal therapist.